Theatre Center at the Grande Center CUNY. Most of you might know, I'm Frank, who runs the Segal Center here. I created this festival. It's the 20th. It's actually the first time I curated it, because for 19 times, I always invited young kids, young producers, young people with ideas to create something. Come in front here for their chairs. But we only started in August. It looked like CUNY was closed till March. It didn't look like we could get in. I couldn't get the rooms. It was unclear how I could hire people. So, but still, it turned out into something, I think, hopefully inspiring. And one of the great things, of course, is to have with us a company that we do not see enough and a lot here in New York City. It's the Great Nature Theater of Oklahoma. So a great welcome to Pavol and Kelly. And I think we are going to do it a prelude style, which, you know, nobody has to present anything, sell anything, impress anyone. It's almost friends, lots of colleagues here. So it's just a sharing, as if you would be invited at your home, and we would get maybe a good Slovenian tea or coffee or something. So first, how are you guys today?
Good.
Yeah.
Is it on? You have to push it up so it's, you see a little blue light.
Yeah.
The blauer bloomer of the romantics, yes. Here, so come over here, come closer. What are you up to at the moment?
Yeah, we only agreed to do this because it's you and me, yeah. You know, and most of our work has been made in Europe, not through any desire of ours to make it in Europe, but that's just kind of where it's led us. And so you were one of the first people to offer us a place to try out something new, which was Poetics, which was like our first show that we were making.
I think it was the first prelude.
Yeah.
I remember you guys up there, and it was the first show maybe you did ever or something, or one of the
first. Well, it was the first with that group of people which we work with now for a really long time. And so, and I think I keep reading that we've stopped making theater, that we don't do it anymore, that the company is over, and it's absolutely not true. We've been working our asses off, but it's just that it's really hard to bring anything back. And now, of course, like half of the company lives in Europe, and it's a lot harder. So we've been lucky that Frank has actually like made trips to see and seen more of the work than most people here. And so he asked us if we wanted to come and talk about what we've been doing. And I think the last thing that was here was at the Skirball Center. We did Pursuit of Happiness, which was the first thing that we really made after Life and Times. We kind of got embarked on this Life and Times project, which was like a multi-year, multi-episode, involved big chunks of everybody's life in the company. And, it ground us down at a certain level. You know, if people wanted to have babies, and like the show had no room for that or for anyone to have a life, including us. So it was really stressful. And so we finished that out as best we could. And then we kind of took a step back and like said, what we'd like to do is maybe get out of a theater. We felt like we were doing a week here, a week there, and we had no we had no basis in like reality and like a place, or like, you know, there was just like a sense that life was very shallowly lived. And so we asked for like to be able to work outdoors and to work deeply over time in a specific space. And that was the start of a whole new kind of work for us. We were asked by a festival to make something specifically for, like, there were 9 small towns in Germany, all kind of like loosely connected. And we were supposed to engage with the community in each of these spaces and to find something that related to the place and the people. So Pavel asked people to get in touch with him and write him letters and be pen pals with him. We visited the place over, you know, different parts of the year and time, and we found that like the big thing that connected all of them was that they, all these places were somehow in the Nibelungen, the big epic German myth. And so we wrote a screenplay that of something that we thought would be impossible to do, or we would need their help. And they, we somehow convinced the community to, like, you know, we need a Viking ship. Somebody actually had one, you know, like they had, we need the Nibelungen treasure. So like some local artists collected everything shiny from the, you know, like it included CDs, junk jewelry, you know, and it was the first work that we made that was kind of like with a community, with mostly amateur people using the camera as an audience. Like the camera became the proxy audience, and everyone else was was performing and making this with us, because we just realized like the most interesting thing for us in the work was always the rehearsals, you know. Yes.
What is nature of theater of Oklahoma, and what kind of work do you make?
Oh, that's a big question. We like to say we make the work that we don't know how to make, and we try to like attack something that we don't really understand or know much about. Yeah, sometimes we write it, sometimes we've made it with interviews with people. It's taken a lot of different forms over the years, but we usually try to do something that we have no permission to do or to deal with. Like our one of our last things was a story ballet, just because and hopefully we'll get to bring that to the Skirball Center again in 2024, but we made it in 2018, which shows you just how difficult it is to get things done in New York. And but you know, it's a form we have no relationship with, and so we have to learn everything that we can possibly as amateurs ourselves know about story ballet, about where it comes from, about what's in a story ballet, and we try to just approach it with like a beginner's mind. It's just as ignorantly as possible. So like that is something, but it's included, it's included performance, it's included film, and we made a book, we've, you know, and then these pieces, we made three different kind of, we called them like performance film projects, where the, you know, again, the camera is kind of the audience and everyone else helps us somehow make it as best we can. We usually try to set up something that would be impossible or that we would think that we couldn't get, like a burning building, and then somehow like somebody builds us like, you know, a doghouse, and we set it on fire and we pretend, and we, you know, and it was good for us to just like to need something from people and to kind of have to ask them to give us something. And then in part because of the Doris Duke Performing Artist Award, we had some extra funding for ourselves to be able to devote time to this. We learned how to edit and make a movie that we could then bring back and give to them. So, you know, part of it was paid, which was the, you know, the making it time. And then there's the making it time, which is us making mistakes and trying to learn how to edit and make a professional looking movie style thing that they can then, you know, the next year we were invited back to the same festival and we did it as a red carpet event, you know, so they all got to like walk the red carpet, all these people, you know, hundreds of people that were in it had made the treasure, had like set things on fire for us, and we give them something back. So I guess you would call it like kind of community-based art, but you know, like I don't know what people call these kinds of things anymore, but it was a chance for us to figure out.
So you spend also a very long time for everybody. It is the Wagnerian stories, you know, who also took that mythos. They redid it, you know, and with their own style. How much time did you spend there? And why didn't you do an opera with actors and opera singers? Why did you do that? And how much time did you spend with the people?
It was over the course of a year. You know, we would do a week here, a week there, come back, you know, as we were getting more and more sure of what, you know, the first time you don't know what you're going to even write or who's there or what the places look like. We tried to set it in the places that they found for us to work in. And then the second time you come back and you try to cast this, the parts that you have, and you try to, tell people more what you need. And then the third time we came back and we shot it in like 3 weeks or something ridiculous like that. It was a 3.5 hour long film in the end. And, so we went home and like kind of just had all this footage. And we shot it silent. We've always been interested in the silent movie genre as like a kind of like, you can see people learn to act for the first time. So that's, and the Nibelung and the Fritz Lang classic was like a big, it was a big source of inspiration for us working on No Dice. So that was nice to kind of come back to and revisit that. I used all the music from the original, and they managed to get the rights to use the music from the Fritz Lang film. And and then we brought it back to them.
So in other words, a company that has a very hard time to be presented in New York City, but they play at the Burgtheater in Vienna and the big Schauspielhauses, you know, in Europe. Though instead of for that project going into an opera and doing it with professional singers, that we do it outside, but with people from a community, and they spend almost a year of their lives and with it. Pavol, also for you, what is the philosophy behind this? Why do you do this?
For us, like Kelly alluded to, it's the best way to appreciate the work is to actually make the work. You know, I used to be a security guard at the Metropolitan Museum of Art, and I never really, I knew paintings were great, but I never really appreciated them. You know, I could look at a Vermeer and I was like, well, that's nice. Or anything, you know, and so until I spent 12 hours in the gallery guarding it and actually had to try to copy it with my own hands to see the gestures that it took to make that. And so I would just keep drawing all these paintings and realize that, you know, this is the only way really for me to find a way to appreciate the work. And so then we, as Kelly said, we instead of being a spectator, we wanted to find a way that whoever wants to experience the work must make it. And making the film, we always thought of it as theater projects, even though people said like, oh, they quit making theater and they're making films. So no, not really. For us, it was always a theater project wherever the shooting itself was the performance. You know, we would invite as many people as came, and the audience, whoever came, you know, and I wouldn't call it participatory art. You know, it wasn't like that. You know, it was just us going to a place, coming and involving the people who were in charge, you know, talking to the mayor, you know, in the Odenwald, where the Nibelungen story takes place. You know, we would talk to the mayors of each community, each village, and give them a specific, here's these three scenes, we'll come in here, you read what it says in here and do the best you can to make it possible. And they were all impossible scenes, you know, it's not like they were shot lists or anything. They were
needed a dragon.
You know, we needed a dragon. And so, you know, then in Lindenfels, there's a dragon museum. And so the guy has a little lizard that he calls a dragon, and he's got all kinds, you know, so we use that, whatever, so you try to create an impossible task, and then you squeeze the juice out of the community. You squeeze the juice out of the area, like it's an orange. With having still, you know, I don't want us to sound like we're like good people, you know, that we're just, you know, we're still interested in making rigorous, amazing, revolutionary art. It's not, you know, it's not like, yay, we want to embrace humanity and make them all feel good about themselves. No, it was, you know, we're still, but we were always inspired by the garbage aesthetics of the 60s and 70s New York avant-garde cinema, and, you know, Jack Smith and Warhol and all those people that made things out of stolen film, and you know, I just don't. We don't have a need for a professional opera singer when we can get you to sing it, you know.
Yeah, and when we would cast these things, I think what our biggest question was is like, why do you want to do this? And everybody had a different reason, a very personal reason. And like, that's kind of all I'm interested in is, what is your investment in doing this? Do you like to work with other people? Do you want to, you know, do you, because we're going to be working on it like 12, 13 hours a day. We'd be like, you know, do you, is that okay with you? Yes. You know, and you know, for these guys too, we decided that the way that we would physically connect these places was we would ride our bikes, to like from town to town, like a, like, cause we were really into the Tour de France and we wanted to also get healthy. And so we, you know, we all like went by bicycle, and this was also its own kind of event. So it's just, it was like, for us, just like, how big can we think about theater and how many people can it involve? And the nice thing about shooting it silent was Pavel is, you know, able to direct people live. And, you know, shouted them like, more blood, you know, and like, kill him, down, down. And, you know, so it just, it becomes like, I think we were looking for like, how is it fun for us again? Honestly, it was a selfish thing on my part too, to just like, I want to know again why I do this, because sometimes it just becomes such a drain and a drag. And it had become that in a way that I didn't want it to be. I don't ever want it to be a job.
And then we did the same thing in Berlin and Cologne, where they saw the Nibelungen, then it became a little bit of a bigger scale, you know. And then it, but it still worked, where we had, okay, we need pigs, because we shot everything backwards, and then we turned it around to make it forward, because it was a science fiction film, so we wanted people to move a little weird. But and we had pigs, and so we said, we, you know, the pigs need to learn to walk backwards. And so, but we got three pigs that the people that trained them, they trained them to walk backwards, you know. But, and so it was, you know, so we shot parts of it in Cologne, parts of it in Berlin, and then made this film. And then the third project, but there again, it was just huge crowd scenes, you know, just things that, you know, everybody always says, well, you're going to make a film like, wow, that's cost so much money. It's like, I don't know. It's free because we have a camera and we can just do it for free. I don't know what it doesn't cost anything. I don't know what you're talking about. It's like, well, but the catering budget is so big. It's like, I don't know. I'll just bring my own sandwich. I don't know. But
and also, like, you hear about like continuity, you know, like, our movies don't have any continuity. Like, sometimes it's raining and one, you know, you film the one guy, it's raining, you film the reaction shot, it's not raining. And we just kind of embrace that as like, you know, this is a record of a performance. It's not an attempt to like, you know, suck you into a reality that you might find believable.
So the films were documents of that experience.
And in the way you applied when you first started out, you said, we work without text. We want to see, you know, we don't even know how to work with it.
Yeah.
In a way, you brought that method of questioning everything to a film. But tell a bit about the beginning and how does it relate to what you do now?
I mean, it's always about people expecting us to do something and then we just don't do that.
And we just disappoint,
you know?
So
it's
them.
Like we did a third project, which was in the Austrian countryside, you know, based loosely on Alfred Jelinek's Die Kinder der Toten. And that was because we had Ulrich Seidel was the producer, so it got more distribution and it was all over the festivals and it won prizes. And so the next thing everybody was like, so what's your next film? You know, so we said, well, we don't make any more films. And so it's always like that, you know. So it's like we in episode one of Life and Times, it was all sung and live music. And so the next one is like, well, let's not, you know, everybody's like, oh yeah, we're gonna see the singing and the live music, they're so great. And then those people show up and it's like, oh no, that's not, it's like dancing now, and that's not live music. That's crazy. I don't like that.
And tell a bit about Life and Times. I mean, we showed, by the way, the Nibelungen here. We were the American premiere, I guess.
Oh, yeah. No, you were.
At the Segal Festival. Yeah.
We've also got to see a very selfish question. How is there any way for our American friends to see that work?
Yeah, I actually like also learned how to burn Blu-rays. And yeah, no, I have them, but nobody, you know, I haven't like, nobody wants them. So if you want one, yeah, just write me. Okay.
Okay, you get free films. But yeah, tell a bit about Life and Times, that incredible ideas with interviews and phones and people who haven't seen it. And what was the idea for that?
It was part of like a lot of, we basically generated all of the material that we used for like 10 years of making work within like a short 3-month period. And it was just, you know, I think Pavel was waiting for me to finish work on something. And we had just finished a production and he was lonely. And one of the things that we kept getting asked with whatever we were doing was like, well, where's the story? You know, because we were interested in being experimental artists and we didn't really think about the story. So we started thinking a lot about story.
Yeah. And I called because when you direct a play, it's very social and you're working with a lot of people and then you stop and then you don't see anybody for 9 months. And so I just felt like, what's this, you know, this time between, what is it, you know, how do I lose track? How do I lose contact with humanity? And so I just called, but I still wanted to work. You know, I hate hanging out with people and it's just hanging out. So I called about 15 people in my contact list and asked them if they want to be a part of this, where I would call them anytime I want to talk to somebody, call them, and I would record the phone calls. And so I would just call anybody, and those people agreed to have the phone calls recorded. And then I would ask them sometimes to tell me a story. First, we did the Romeo and Juliet, where I would, where we're just talking about, you know, because nobody paid us. So I called people at work on their jobs and I would just talk to them so that the people who are paying them paid for our work.
That was the joke, is that it's like, it was our first corporate art project, yeah. You know, but you were asking people, can you tell me a story?
Tell me a story, but they couldn't tell, nobody could tell a story. So it's like, hey, nobody gives a shit about stories. So then I said, okay, I still want to pursue this. So let's see let's see if there's a story that everybody knows. And, you know, I never read Romeo and Juliet. So I said, okay, tell me the story of Romeo and Juliet. So then everybody told me a story of Romeo and Juliet and we heard it. And we recorded it, and then we made a show, Romeo and Juliet, out of these recordings of people.
But this was still like, all these recordings were made within 3 months. We hadn't started work on No Dice. We didn't really know, like, you just made this pile.
I just wanted, it was necessary. It was out of necessity. I just felt I just needed to talk to people. That's all, you know.
Yeah, and then we just ended up with this pile of material that was fairly innocent because nobody, even us, knew what we were going to do with it. It was all kind of loosely around story. We also did, like, Pavel asked a certain actor to tell him the story of Rambo because he was really, really into this story of Rambo and the difference between the Rambo movie and the Rambo book. And so, but he also like was talking while he was working. I think he was doing like medical records or something.
Yeah, he's in cancer research.
Yeah.
But it was, you know, but even I called him at work and he had to stop talking because he had to go do something. And I said, well, let me call you back and I'll finish the story. I said, it's not going to work. We can't do it. Because it had to not be prepared. It had to not be. So I told him we're not doing it because he had to stop. But then, you know, a little later I called him when he wasn't ready, you know, so it was more about just what's the archaeology of the mind, what gets stuck in there.
And so to answer your question, Frank, like the last thing we were going to do is Pavel asked, can you tell me your life story? And he called the first person, who was Kristen, and she like got 2 hours into the phone call and she was still only at like age 5. And so they said like, I'll call you again and like, we'll finish this up. And it took like 10 different phone calls. And then after that, it was like, well, there's really no sense in talking to anybody else or asking anybody else this question because she's answered it so thoroughly. But all this stuff just went into the closet. We started playing with some of the material and made No Dice. And then, yeah, Life and Times was, we got an offer from the Berg Theater in Vienna, which is the place where Mozart premiered Così fan tutti. And so we knew that it had to be something like high art that we couldn't do. And we thought, like, maybe the most epic thing you can do with this really boring story would be to make an opera. And Rob was learning, one of our actors, Rob, was, we were doing No Dice at the time, I think, still, and he was learning how to play the ukulele. And he was pretty good at, like, kind of working fast. And we gave him a page of this, and we said, like, can you see what you can do with this? And he came back with something that interested us, and that was it. You know, it just started out with the ukulele. Then we found out, like, well, most of the actors, like, know how to play something, kind of. You know, some guys took oboe in, like, high school. They gave us an assistant director while we were there. We had no need for an assistant director, but he played piano. So Rob got a pianist, you know, and it became, like, yeah, our attempt at opera. But it was totally, like, usually what we do is in response to an invitation or, like, a, you know, a proposal, you know, like, what are we going to do at the Berg Theater in Vienna? Like, this is a super duper fancy theater that we've been working in basements. Our first theater was a fourth floor walk up with, like, 30 folding chairs. Like, what do we do in that space? What does that space want? What does it expect? Who's the audience for that space? And, like, what's our answer back to that?
Yeah, it was a big theatrical machine built over centuries, rooted in a very old tradition of the Italian theater. And they meet you as a company that can't work in New York. So it's kind of two extreme evolutions of machines, institutions, or non-institutions. But something interesting came out.
And they gave us three of their actors who were, you know, like that theater, there's portraits painted of these actors as you walk into it. Like, they are institutions in and of themselves. And we said, like, we'll work with those people and our people, but they have to spend as much time in New York as we spend in Vienna with them. And so when they came to New York, we had, I think, a residency up at this, like, high school for the arts in the Bronx. You know, we worked in the cafeteria, you know. And they were completely shocked at, this is the way, you know, we were like, this is what is the stuff of our work. And this is where we come from. And I still feel that way. I still am not a European artist. I make work here, but it's so frustrating because I feel like the last three pieces we've made have been deeply, you know, from Pursuit of Happiness to No President, the Story Ballet, and our last one, Bert Torito, have all been kind of like morality plays. They've all been consumed with these questions of, like, power and morality and, like, political stuff going on here and our feelings about it, like, kind of from afar, but also, like, you know, every time I come back, something new has happened, you know, like the Roe v. Wade thing was happening while I was away. It's like, every time I come back, it's a new country. And it's frustrating that we haven't been able to bring more of these things back, because I feel like it's in dialogue with this place and with my home, and yet I'm outside of it, you know.
What does it, I mean, it's a simple question, but what does it mean for you guys to do theater? I remember we did a Segal talk in Corona times when nobody knew what would happen. I remember Pavol saying, well, if we can perform, then I go and perform. And if mm-hmm. I get infected and die, so what? But I can't live without doing theater. Why do you do it? What is your artistic motivation? Why do you do it?
I think we ask ourselves that fresh every time.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's the only question we have going, you know. There's no other, really, no other, there, we have no story to tell, no, you know, no, it's just, that is the question we're asking. That is the only question, really, with every project. And that is, if we teach, we ask, like, what are you doing here? it's crazy that you're here, you know. And so when, you know, so it's not so, as it's not as dramatic as, like, well, I'll die for theater.
Well,
it's,
you,
like,
were very serious. I remember.
I am very serious because I just don't understand why we cling to a miserable life that much. You know, I mean, I, It's just like life, we just seem to like be so miserable. And like, I don't know why we're really fighting that hard to stay alive if it's not all out, you know. It needs to be the most, you know, a theater space is an epic space. You have to grow up into it as a person, you know. It's not a little tiny phone screen or a computer screen or a TV screen, you know. It's just, you know, you need to really expand your elbows and fill that space with something. And I feel like we're just being always asked to do less, and I'm just not really interested in doing less, you know. So if we can't do more, the project that we're working on now is like, let's make theater in the entire America. So our project is to travel across America on motorcycles and make theater in that way, and then find a way
to
do
it this summer, right?
Tell
a little bit about it.
Yeah, I mean, we've been traveling across America for more like, four years. We've made three long trips. The only area we have left is, you know, Texas, Nevada, and California, and that New Mexico. But everything else, we've traveled, and we've talked to people and gotten to know those places and in a way have performed ourselves, have performed bikers in those places, and have made other people perform themselves in Walmart parking lots. So it's just trying to increase the scope, even if just for ourselves at this point, you know, but somehow I'm sure it'll morph and change into something that, you know, we used to be on the road 9 months out of the year, and the COVID pretty much just wiped us out. We have one tour date coming up, and that's it, you know, and and that's fine. You know, it's not, you know, we know that I can always go, you know, I work in a typewriter shop and on 17th Street. So it's not a problem for us. We've never wanted to be professionals. We could have pursued after Burgtheater or after Fox, you know, the last show we did in Vienna was Volkstheater. And, you know, I could just make a phone call and get another job like that. You know, it's not what we want to do.
And just for everyone to know, the Burgtheater in Vienna, even great German directors who for 10 years are the director of the Berliner Ensemble, they wait for a call of a book theater. It's a very big deal. So let me think again. So you this summer spent on two Harley Davidson. You would just drive around, you perform them yourselves, and you collect material, you do audio, you do recordings, or so you have to, or you're on one motorcycle. How does that work?
No, we each, I mean, this was also just part of, I feel like you get to a part, you know, we challenge people to do what they can't do. And this for me was a big challenge. I mean, I'm probably the person who would be voted least likely to be a biker. I hadn't ridden a car or anything for like 30 years. And, you know, and I just thought like, I want to push myself to do that. And it scares me. But I've grown myself like into, I like that it expands my sense of space. Like I've traveled a lot more too outside of New York than I have in a while. And I feel like what we were feeling at the time too was like, you know, you just live in this bubble of New York and you think that everybody thinks like you, but actually like it's very different. You know, when we took our first trip up to Maine, just going through like upstate New York, you know, like what we were seeing and what we were hearing and what, like you just, I felt like very curious about all of it because I just, America's very different. I don't understand what's happening. And so all of these, like, they're not really vacations. It's more like, I just want to know like who's out there. And like, and also it's from an inability to speak to like people in my family who are very different. What I found with the biking is like, motorcycles attract a very diverse, actually, group of people. You know, like there's everybody from like, you know, hardcore lesbian activists to like very conservative military guys. And all of them will come up and ask you, like, can you rev your motor for me? Like, how cool is that? Like, how many CCs? And like, I still don't understand a lot of it. But, you know, it's a meeting point is what it is. And when you're on the bike, you're very vulnerable. Like the moment you stop it, people can come up to you, touch you. You're also vulnerable to the elements. I know the surface of roads, it sounds kind of like nothing, but like I started to judge America too from the surface of its roads. Like we went through like this part of East Cleveland that I think, you know, they had potholes big enough to swallow you. And it felt so, I didn't understand what a food desert was until we drove through and like, there's no food here. We were so hungry. We could not stop the bike and it looked just shot. I was shocked at the poverty. And I'm ashamed to say that I just didn't know how a lot of Americans were living. And I sometimes feel too, like I don't maybe fit in this area that I'm going, like, what do they think of a couple of white people on motorbikes? What do they think that I believe? And then I go back and once we're through a place, I look up like, well, what is this East Cleveland? Like what used to be there? It used to be like the mansion place for Carnegie and Rockefeller and all those people are still buried there. There's a cemetery in the middle of this food desert where like the titans of industry are all buried. And that's amazing to me. So I feel like right now it's just going through the country as ignorantly as possible in a way, which is not too hard because I feel very ignorant as I'm going through it and reading about whatever sparks my interest in talking to people. And like, you know, we don't record. I find it really difficult. I don't think it's possible to record strangers. I think the reason that recording stuff worked was because we were working with people who trusted us to whatever we were doing with the material. So a lot of it is talking to people and. Mm-hmm.
So you were not on the road, not for 9 months. You went yourself in the kind of a tradition of a Kerouac, of a road movie, of a Ulysses searching for a golden fleece or to understand where we are. How does it make you feel that you don't have a company here? Most of you have a company members in Europe, an ensemble. How do you feel about this? And where is your company? How does that work? How do you organize your work?
I feel like our company is really big, but you know, like because it embraces like all the people who made work with us, which now are, you know, like there's a lot of people in Europe and also
who are the people and how do you connect to them and how do you create the work?
I mean, some people we just work with once, like on those movies, you know, but like I still see them every once in a while.
There's of course Anne.
Yes.
Anne Gridley. I think she was performing yesterday.
Yeah.
There's Rob. You know, the same people that we started with in Poetics in here are pretty much still, except one, are still part of the work, and they're in the Bertarito, which we made during the pandemic. You know, and they're also in No President, which we made, which was supposed to come here to Skirball right before the pandemic, but then it got canceled. And now we're hoping to, you know, but it's, you know, we made four shows during the pandemic and they're all in storage in Berlin that we're paying for with money that we don't have, you know. So it's not. Those people are committed to the work. They're there. If we're going to do something, they'll do something with us. But it's just, this is the first time, because also theaters in Europe are also getting their funding cut. So nobody's really asking us to do anything. So really it's really kind of back to the beginning for us, where we're just like, oh, well, why are we alive? You know? So it's really a good existential crisis. You know, I think it's, we don't ever want to kind of figure it out, because it's every project is an existential crisis, and this is a big one. You know, one could think, oh, it's a midlife crisis, but I you know, then I'd have had 17 of them already, you know. So it's, you know, it's a it's definitely a crisis. We have no, we like coming back. Everybody, why don't you move to Europe? Because there you could, you know, have, but it's like, I don't, even though I'm I'm not from here, really, this is where I feel at home the most, because New York is where I've lived the longest of my life, but this is where I live, but I have not worked here other than in, you know, working in the shop now. And that's okay with me to not be established, because I think that's the death. You know, I don't want to make it. I always want to make, I want to always make the work out of zero or from the negative, you know. And I feel like right now we're in the minus.
So yeah, we're comfortably in the minus.
Yeah, I mean, even the cultural, you know, it's like we applied for 4 grants that used to give us money, but we got none of them, you know. So because it's, you know, it rightly or wrongly is going to different people. So it's. You know, it's just, and it's fine too. You know, it's like, okay, we will, our aesthetic is the aesthetics of practical solutions. That's all, you know, like if we have this and you and here, okay, let's try to figure out a way how to convince you to do the show. I'll do the show with you and we can do this and still be as ambitious and not think small, but still be as ambitious as we can possibly be. The way Jack Smith was, or Ken Jacobs, or you know, any of those people that made great art, epic art with nothing. You know, it's just, and Europeans don't understand it, because they always wait for, you know, when we teach somewhere, they're always like, oh, I'm waiting for my money to come in to make a show. It's like, no, you have to make 2 shows for free ahead of time and then lie about it and tell them like you haven't made the shows because you know already that what the shows are. You know, it's like we always made 2 shows ahead, didn't tell anybody and told them like, ah, we'd like to make this show, Romeo and Juliet. We've already made it and done performances of it. It's like it was already. But then we asked for the money for it afterwards. Once we made it already, we didn't, you know, it's like not waiting for permission and not waiting for permission to, you know, I want to make a ballet. Well, fuck it. I'm going to make a ballet. I don't know how, I've never choreographed anything. I don't know how to dance. I've never been to a ballet. Let's just go see a ballet. So we went to see Nutcracker. I was like, okay, great. Good enough. I know enough now. We can do a ballet. So then we did a story ballet based on that bad seat from the very corner where I could just see like a little corner of the stage at the Met. And that was it. You know, it's just that's just where we are. And that's our company, you know.
Yeah, but you're right, like the core is still the people that we started with. I mean, we're very lucky in that they're very dedicated and we're dedicated to them. And we're lucky to get to work with them.
You move between the two worlds, these two continents, or some say actually there are two universes or two different stars in Europe and here. What do you think about New York theater and what do you think about European theater?
It's sometimes it's always, you know, it's like when people like Richard Foreman are gone, or you know, when you ask people if they even heard of Richard Foreman, they haven't, you know. It's just and then sometimes people ask, you know, when we want to talk to people about the work, they ask us about contact lists because they think that it's, you know, if you know the right people, then you can do the work or somehow, you know. So yeah, you know, it's you know, it's a loaded question, so I don't want to, you know.
I feel like we come from an older New York theater, and you know, a lot of the artists that inspired us are, you know, like we worked, you know, Pavel worked for free for like 2 years for Richard Foreman. Like, I mean, I don't think anybody wants to work for free anymore. Like I put in my time And other theaters, we've been lucky that we've had people that open their rehearsals to us to watch them work and to help them work. So that's where we come from. And I feel like it seems more professional to me now, but with people talking to me about the industry, it's not an industry. It's really and I feel like we're all trying to treat it right now as an industry and as a thing that's like banking or something that, it should, of course, in Europe, be able to pay us all a living wage and have health insurance, but it doesn't. There's nothing to support it. There's none of these theaters have steady streams of income. We're all relying on private donations. And I think we come from you do it with love because you have to, and it's almost like a religious zealot thing. And if you got to work in a typewriter store to make it happen, that's what you're going to do. And I always tell people in Europe, I can work fearlessly because I know nobody can take that work away from me. Nobody can give me permission to make that work. Then nobody can give me, I don't need money. I don't need your money. I don't need your space. I can do it with a piece of cardboard and a tarp, just give me time and give me people who care and I can make it. And that's what those films were in a way, some of the people did it because they just wanted to make a movie on their own and we gave them permission. They could see us fumbling with it and then they can make their own movie, nobody should give you permission. It's not an industry. Don't expect to be paid for it. It's a privilege to have people show up and you should just do your best for the people who are willing to come and share that work with you. And so that's what New York is to me, or was, or, that's where I come from and where we come from.
What do you think about the extraordinary response you got from your work? There's this, the Florian Malzacher who put out the book, and just the contributors, and everybody. It is stunning.
Yeah, you said we're not here to sell. We brought six copies of a book. If anybody wants it, it's I don't know, how much are we going to charge? 25 bucks?
25, that's what we paid for them.
25 bucks, but, we always sell something,
It might be more worth than a t-shirt,
We have a box of t-shirts at home, but I didn't want to bring it because I didn't know if anybody would show up. I didn't want to walk around with
that's
what
walking home.
Because I don't take it for granted that anybody's going to show up, It's I'm ready for no one to show up.
We were very lucky. Florian wanted to put a book together, and it forced me to kind of go through all of the old, I had postcards from some of the shows that we made in New York. I used to make those postcards on, I worked at a law firm. I would use their Xerox machine before anybody got to the office and stuff, but nobody even remembers postcards anymore. And so anyway, remember when?
Just a quarter.
Yeah, no, but yeah, he put that book together.
So you brought your New York aesthetic for what the way you worked here to Europe. What did you bring back? What did you learn?
The harder it is, the better it's going to be. So you have to just be willing to let it be hard.
And I think
and work hard. Even in Europe, you can those people get paid $5,000 a month, 5,000 euros a month plus $400 per each performance they do, and yet they don't show up on time and they work like shit. Whereas it means nothing really whether you get paid or not. If you're not willing to really work hard, it's not, it is a mission. You have to approach it with a missionary zeal. And art is a kind of religion. Otherwise there's no need for it really, to me. It serves this other, is it just to hang on the wall or make a decoration? That's not what we're interested in. So
but I think Europe taught me that there are big audiences for that kind, for a kind of demanding work that I feel like sometimes it's hard to convince theaters to, everybody's so afraid to lose what little funding they have that they kind of tend, I think, here to sometimes underestimate the audience.
Yeah, it's just we don't feel weird in Europe doing the best work we can do. It's not and explaining, oh, what do you do? Oh, we make theater. And they don't think it's either Shakespeare in the Park or a musical, you know, whereas like a major existential crisis, if we go to the Midwest and South or something, and somebody asks, oh, so what do you do for a living? It's like, oh my God, how do I even start explaining it to you? Like, you just have no idea, because just there's just no connection to that kind of work that we do. So it gave us like, okay, we're not completely insane and weirdos. We're just doing the best work that we can possibly make, and there's people who watch it, and they're not like seven people from the whole city that are like want to see weirdo things, you know, at midnight. But it's like a normal thing, you know, that you can, and it's not avant-garde, it's not experimental, it's not devised, whatever the bullshit words we use, that it's like, whoa, woo, you know, it's just theater, you know, we just make theater and that's it, you know. It's
to ask the question, what are the great works of theater you loved? What did you see that really inspired you, that formed you?
Yeah, I mean, we talk about this in the book, but like there was a weekend where we managed to see like Reza Abdo's Quotations from a Ruined City, Wooster Group's Frank Dell, Temptation of St. Anthony, and also Richard Foreman, I've Got the Shakes.
My head was a sledgehammer.
And that, like, yeah. And
one weekend, you know, it was just all in one weekend. And
and when I was here, like, I was here, like, in 92, and I saw everything at the BAM Next Wave Festival, including, like, Robert Wilson's Einstein at the Beach, which was, like, it just took me on a journey of being, like, you know, bored, rhapsodized. Like, I mean, I felt so much during all of this, like angry at it, like gotta go bathroom, hungry. So like that one also, you know, and also Gats, you know, there've been inspiring works by people that we, you know, that we've been in the same kind of cadre with, co-conspirators in this, and yeah, those things, I feel like, yeah, I wish I could have seen more in Europe. You know, I'm sure that would have also shaped me, but like there was more than enough to shape. And also all of the work, we lived four blocks away from Anthology Film Archives. And at a certain point, you know, like when we were chasing the kind of aesthetic of like Richard Foreman and Wooster Group, who had just, they had spaces. So their work was lived in, and it was prop heavy and set heavy and design heavy in a way that we wished that we could be, but we couldn't. So to me, the going to the Anthology Film Archives and seeing, you know, Jack Smith or the Kuchar brothers, and just how you know, Mike Kuchar was there projecting his own stuff, you know, and like Ken Jacobs, you know, we would go to the gardens at ABC, and like he's there, he's with his own machine that he built to show his like Lumiere thing. And so just being in that environment and seeing people who work with, like, you know, none of them are rich and none of them had what they needed to make their work, and they made it anyway. And so like at a certain point, I feel like those people gave us permission in a way that I hope sometimes we can give other people permission to just throw themselves into it. You know, like those guys gave me hope that I could make work with nothing. Mm. And once we actually embraced our actual like means of making work and said like, this is it. And it's gonna be, you know, we're gonna make it with a phone call and with iPods, cause everybody's got iPods, and we're gonna make it in this fourth floor walk up. Like that, once I accepted that was the way it was gonna be, and that's when we started making good work.
Before we come to the audience, what would be a dream project? Say someone in New York said, we produce you guys, don't think about what costs or where. Now, what would you love to do? What would be a project?
I mean, no president started here. The idea was we were going to do it in the atrium at MoMA. But then they realized like, oh, you actually have to like rehearse and you have to do stuff and it involves people. And it's like, oh, no, let's not do it. you know, I mean, it's we talked also about doing the Kafka's America as a starting point, you know, a lot of just New York locations, but with the films kind of things, but you know, it would be super hard in New York, in America to do this kind of project that in Europe you could do innocently, because here everybody would think that, you know, you just need, because that it's like a movie, so you need to pay a lot, you know, or something, or you need to like get permissions, whereas we just like did, we just went and did it, you know. In Europe, you know, nobody was like, hey, yeah, you need permission, you need this, you need this, you need this.
And liability insurance and stuff, like just the idea, like as we started to think about how do we do something like that here, which we wanted to, it was so much harder to envision that, like, you know, even getting people to like, a lot of our work would involve like working with local people and like, you know, involving them in like 8 minutes at the end of like Life and Times episode 2. And it starts to be a whole conversation about like, well, what are you, you know, you're asking me to work for free. I should be paid. I'm not saying that you shouldn't, but, you know, like we want to involve as many people as possible and we don't have the money. And so if you get something out of this, like we said, we work for free for like years for other people. And that kind of was, it was this kind of thing where like you give a little and you get something from the people that you work with, and it just doesn't, it seems less and less possible here. So I would love to, you know, if somebody wanted to give us a space for like a longer period of time, like we still work as we have from the beginning out of our apartment. You know, when we made this ballet, people were dancing off into the bathroom because that's what we, you know, that's where the wings are. But I can't invite people to see stuff in my apartment, you know, so it'd be nice. I really, the biggest gift anyone ever has given us here has been Ryan at Downtown Art, who gave us, she ran a theater for youth program that was four flights up in this building. And she said, I'm not using it at night. If you want to use it at night and in exchange, make something with me and the young people, then, you know, you can use it for free. And so having like a space, and I think most people too, it's like, if you have a space and you can invite people into that space here, that's huge. That's all. That's a big thing. Yeah, it would be huge.
We have a big space panel on Monday. And how much more time do we have? Okay. Okay, but so I apologize. I got a bit carried away. So, but maybe you hang out a bit outside if you have questions to ask.
If anybody wants and any books,
people have to get this book. Okay, so thank you, really. Thank you for talking about your work. And whoever is listening, if there are any producers listening for complete shows are in Berlin.
Yeah.
So they're in Berlin. Anybody wants to put them up, just write us or write them and they will do it. Thank you.